Okay, so we'll continue this video with graphing rational functions, which are very similar to polynomials, which we discussed in the last video. But the only difference, of course, the main difference, is the asymptotes, and we'll see how they come into play. So first, find intercepts, which is usually a lot easier for rational functions, if any. Of course, it may not have any. And asymptotes, same thing, if any. Then find max, min, if any, the same way, and intervals where f of x is increasing or decreasing. This is very similar as for polynomials. Then find concavity intervals and points of inflection, if any, using second derivative. So for number two, we use first derivative. For number two, we use second. Then the big difference is to find behavior near vertical asymptotes. So usually the graph goes to positive infinity or negative infinity. We'll talk about how to find that. And the behavior at infinity, especially if you don't have a horizontal asymptote. If you do, that kind of answers for itself. So on your homework, you can always compare with your graphing calculator when you have doubts, but this is kind of the idea. I just posted a couple of examples just for you guys to get the idea. Let's say if we have y equals negative x plus 4 over x plus 2. How we can do this? So y-intercept, we'll plug in 0 for the x, so we'll get 4 over 2, which is just 2. X-intercept, we can set the whole expression equal to 0. We can just multiply by denominator and it goes away. So we'll have negative x plus 4 equals to 0, which means x is equal to negative 4, and the negatives will cancel, so x is 4. So we'll get 4 comma 0 is your intercept. Vertical asymptote, if you recall, that's where the denominator is 0, if you cannot cancel it. So that's x equals negative 2. Horizontal asymptote is, if you recall, we can compare the degrees or look at the leading coefficients, negative x over x, that will give us negative 1. So it's y equals negative 1. Actually, horizontal asymptotes are essentially behavior at infinity. Remember how we used to find, limits at infinity. It's kind of the same thing here. Okay, so this is step one. Step two, we find the first derivative using quotient rule. So remember x plus denominator squared, then we'll have derivative of numerator times denominator minus derivative of the denominator, which is just 1, times negative x plus 4. So what do we get here? Negative x minus 2 plus x minus 4. As it tends to happen, x is canceled. So we end up with negative 2 minus 4, that's negative 6 over x plus 2 squared. Again, the derivative is not defined in the denominator at x equals negative 2, but this is not a critical number since it's a vertical asymptote. The original function has to be defined at that point, and it's not. So it's just a vertical asymptote, which we keep in mind is not a critical number, but we still are going to need to put it on the number line, the first derivative test, because it may break up the intervals of increasing, decreasing, and so on. So we'll see how that works. Now let's set it equal to 0. Now if we multiply by denominator as before, by x plus 2 squared, we'll get negative 6 equals to 0, which is a contradiction. They're not equal. So we don't have any critical numbers. It's not possible. So that means, in general, no max or min, which for rational functions, that happens a lot, actually. But doesn't mean we cannot test for increasing, decreasing. So what I did here, remember how the vertical asymptote was x equals negative 2? So we still have to put that because we still can figure out our function is increasing, decreasing, even if it doesn't have any max or min. So if you have a vertical asymptote, make sure you still test it. So I picked up negative 3, and then I picked up, let's say, 0, you know, something easy, and then I plugged it into the derivative, negative 6 over x plus 2 squared, so negative 3, doesn't matter what you plug in denominator, it's going to be squared, but the top is negative, so the whole thing is negative. Same thing for the 0, the whole thing is negative, so the sign doesn't change, but it doesn't matter. However, we do know that the function is decreasing, basically from negative infinity to negative 2 for that piece, but also from negative 2 to infinity for the second piece. Notice how I broke them up because of the vertical asymptote. You'll see that on the graph. And it's not increasing anywhere, so it's none. Okay, so that's how it works. Second derivative, I decided, remember how if it's a constant, you can rewrite it as negative 6 times x plus 2 to the negative 2 power, makes it finding the second derivative easier. So we'll have negative 6 times negative 2, that's 12, times x plus 2 to the negative third power. So we'll get 12 over x plus 2 to the third power is equal to 0. Okay. Again, if I multiply by denominator, 12 does not equal to 0, so we don't have any inflection points, okay? So it does not change concavity, but it, as before, we can still test the vertical asymptote. Why is that? Because even if it does not change concavity, you can still have concave up or down for the function, so we can still test it. So what I did here, I think it does switch concavity because we have a third degree, so I put negative 3. And let's say again, if we try 0, doesn't really matter. So negative 3 plus 2 in the second derivative will give us negative. And remember, cube of a negative number is negative. So here you do get the whole thing is negative. That's how come I put minus. And if we plug in 0, we'll get positive 2 cubed, that's positive, and 12 divided by that is positive. So we find out that it's actually concave down from negative infinity to negative 2. But then it's concave up from negative 2 to infinity. So even though negative 2 is just a vertical asymptote, it does seem to switch concavity. So now let's talk about the graph. Well, you can actually see the graph. But here's what I'm talking about, the asymptote. If you recall the function, let me write this out. F of x was, I believe, negative x plus 4, I think, right? And divided by x plus 2. Then how we figure this out, negative 2 was the asymptote. So as the limit goes to negative 2, there should be a negative in here. I'm going to have to fix this. So as limit goes to negative 2 from the left side, what I'm talking about is plugging in something like negative 2.01, let's say. So the bottom is going to be slightly negative, but the top is going to be negative of the negative. It's going to be positive plus 4 is going to be positive. So you'll have positive number divided by a slight negative number. So the whole thing is going to go to negative infinity. On the other hand, let me erase this. From the right side, if we'll plug in, let's say, negative 1.99, I'm thinking, let's say 1.99. So it's going to be a slightly positive number because we're approaching from the right, from the plus. And then plugging in the top would be positive also. So the whole thing is going to positive infinity. So how does that help us? In behavior at infinity, we have horizontal asymptote. There it's going to go to negative 1. So how does this help us? So we had a couple of points, if you recall. We had, so first thing when I draw, as I draw the asymptotes, I actually drew x equals negative 2 as the vertical, and then y equals negative 1. Then I plotted the y-intercept, 0, 2, and then 4, 0. I plotted both of them. And then I kind of figured out that from there, it goes up because we said it's going to go up to negative 2 from the right or from the positive side. So it's going up. And then from 4 on, it also goes down up to negative 1 because that's what we said, behavior at infinity. And so this is what's happening. Now on the other side, even though we didn't have any points, we do know that, well, first of all, if you recall, the function was concave down. This piece, this arrow right here is going down because this is what we figured out. It's going to be going to negative infinity. So this is what I have going down. And then over here, it's going to go to negative 1 from the left. It is concave down, which is we found from negative infinity to negative 2. It is concave up from negative 2 to infinity. So notice there are no max, min, there are no inflection points, but we still have concavity and we still have, both pieces are actually decreasing if you're going from left to right. So notice they are decreasing. So all that information that we found should make sense at the end when you're putting your graph together. So again, first I drew the asymptotes, then I plotted the points, and then the rest I basically tried to piece it together from the information that's given. And that's how I usually work this. For the second function that I have for you guys is 1 over x squared plus 4x plus 3. This one has a couple of vertical asymptotes. As usual, we start with the intercepts. If we plug in 0, we'll get 1 over 3, which is 1/3. x-intercepts, you set the equation equal to 0, but then again we get the top, 1 equal to 0, which is not true, does not happen. So there are no x-intercepts. Vertical asymptotes, there's two of them here. We're actually going to get x equals negative 3 and x equals negative 1. Horizontal asymptote, if you recall, the degree of the top is less than the bottom, or it's 1 over x squared, we'll get y equals 0. Okay. Step 2, how do we find first derivative? That's actually not too bad. I jumped too far, sorry. If you rewrite the original function as the whole thing to the negative 1 power, you can use chain rule. Again, with constants, you can always try that. So I took the exponent down, negative 1, x squared plus 4x plus 3 to the negative 2 power times the derivative of x squared is 2x and 4x is 4, so 2x plus 4. And you can rewrite it as 2x plus 4, that's negative, over x squared plus 4x plus 3 squared, okay? So the derivative is not defined at the usual asymptotes, the usual suspects, so to speak. However, you can set the numerator equal to 0, because remember, if you set the whole function, you can multiply by denominator. So that's how come I only counted the numerator, negative of the 2x plus 4. Negative didn't really count. I just put there because you can divide by it. So we'll have 2x plus 4 equals to 0, which means 2x is equal to negative 4, which means x is equal to negative 2. So we have one single critical number. And this was the first derivative, which I rewrote right here. This is what we're going to be plugging into. So I plotted, remember how we have to plot not only the critical number, but also the vertical asymptote. So that's how I got negative 3, negative 2, negative 1. And the test points that I picked were negative 4. Now there are no integers between negative 3 and negative 2, but I picked decimals, negative 2.5, negative 1.5, and then I picked 0 to the right. So I listed the derivative, I listed the f of x, so what's happening there? So negative 4, we're plugging in. The denominator is always going to be squared, so we're not going to worry about that. It's just the numerator. So negative 4 times 2, that's like negative 8 plus 4, that's negative, but there is negative on the front, so we're actually getting positive. Function's increasing. Negative 2.5, same thing, we'll get like negative 5 plus 4, but the negatives, two negatives cancel each other. Because of the negative on the outside, so we'll get a plus, it's increasing. Now to the right of negative 2, negative 1.5, however, we'll get negative 3 plus 4, that's positive 1, but there is a negative on the outside. So that's negative, it's decreasing. And at 0, same thing, it's negative, it's decreasing. So we do notice at negative 2, it's going from positive to negative, so we do have a maximum. And I plugged it into the original function. If you recall, 1 over x squared plus 4x plus 3, and I get negative 1, okay? And it is increasing from negative infinity to negative 3, and then from negative 3 to negative 2. So it is increasing on both of those pieces, and then it's decreasing from negative 2 to negative 1, and then from negative 1 to infinity, so on all of those pieces. Okay, second derivative, I'm not going to lie, this was challenging, but it must be done, as it, they say, so you practice with those. So what I did, if you keep the first derivative in mind, square of a square, I got the fourth degree, and then what I did was, the first part was not too bad. I still kept the negative on the outside, that's like a negative constant, so I kept the negative. Then I took the derivative of the top. If you recall, I'm going to scroll up a little bit. Derivative of the top. The top is 2x plus 4. So derivative of that is 2. Times the bottom, which is x squared plus 4x plus 3 squared. Minus, now this is where we have to work a little bit. Chain rule. 2 comes down, so it becomes 2 times x squared plus 4x plus 3 times the derivative of the inside, which is 2x plus 4. Times the top, which is also derivative of the inside. Well, they happen to be the same. So it was 2x plus 4 twice. So this one's derivative of the inside. The second one is the top function. Okay? So again, it looks like a big mess. But what can we do? As usual, there is the common factor of x squared plus 4x plus 3. So I pull that out, cancel the denominator. That gives us 3 in denominator. So what do we have in the numerator? Yeah, it's a little mess, but we can work with this. So I distributed the 2. So 2x squared plus 8x plus 6. And then I basically square them. 2x times 2x is 4x squared. Then we have 8x plus 8x. We'll have plus 16x. And then 4 times 4 is 16. So basically FOIL. And then multiply by negative 2. So I'm getting negative 8x squared minus 32x minus 32. Now it's time to combine the like terms. So I'm getting 2x squared minus 8x squared. That's how come we have negative 6x squared. 8x minus 32x, that's negative 24x, I believe. And then 6 minus 32 is negative 26. And good thing we had negative on the front. You can actually distribute the negative everywhere, and you can get rid of the negative. So this is the final answer, actually. 6x squared plus 24x plus 26 over the cube of x squared plus 4x plus 3. So now take a deep breath, pause for a little bit, but let's go ahead and keep going. All this work, and then the top, if you set it equal to 0, remember, you can always multiply by denominator and get rid of it, so it's only the top that matters. It's never 0. I tried graphing it. It was above x-axis, and that means it's always positive. It's never going to be 0. So there are no inflection points, but remember, it's never that easy for rational functions. We must still plot the asymptotes. So what I did, this was a little challenging, but I'm going to leave it to you guys as an exercise. So you have to pick, let's say, negative 4. Then you have to pick, let's say, negative 2. Then let's say 0. And plug them in into the derivative. Well, 0 is positive. 26 over 3 cubed, you're going to get plus. Negative 2 and negative 4, sit there with a calculator, but hopefully you'll get plus and a minus. I actually did that separate. Okay, so you do get switch of sign, which, what does that mean? It means concavity. We're going to keep in mind to the right of negative 3 and to the right of negative 1, to the left of negative 3, it's going to be concave up, but between negative 3 and negative 1, it's going to be concave down. I didn't write that, but we're going to keep that in mind. Then, these infinity, the limits, I didn't really compute them. I actually really, I took a look at the number line for the first derivative test. We actually figured that out. Let me scroll up to that. Notice how when we're going up to negative 3, the function is increasing. So it's actually going to be going to positive infinity. Now, to the left of negative 3, notice our function's increasing, so it's actually going to be going to negative infinity in order for it to increase from there. And then at negative 1, it's going to negative infinity here. Notice how it's decreasing. But to the right of it, since it's decreasing, it's actually going to be going to positive infinity. You have to visualize this, or maybe think about it with a graph. But I did get those from the first derivative test. That's how I figured all those out. I didn't think too much. So you have to be very visual there. Behavior infinity, they're going to 0. Notice how with a graph, it's all going to make sense now. We only had a single point, but we could figure out the rest of the graph basically from this. We know how the graph is going to go to positive infinity. Remember, the function is increasing, so it has to be above x-axis. Otherwise, it's impossible not to cross y equals 0. So it has to go up, and the whole thing is increasing. And on the left, it's actually going to 0, which is how it's supposed to do, not cross. There are no x-intercepts, so it cannot cross the horizontal asymptote. Sometimes it does cross, but we don't have any intercepts. And over here, it was going down, and we also remember that 2 is a maximum, and the whole thing is concave down, if you remember. And both ends are going down. Remember how it's increasing all the way up to negative 2, but then it's decreasing from negative 2 and on. So really, you can just, like a puzzle, you can piece that together. And then same thing is going up on this side, but then it's going, as we figured that out, remember how it's going to positive infinity. Because the whole thing is decreasing. So again, it has to go to positive infinity in order for it to decrease. Otherwise, it'd be increasing. And it is concave up, so it all makes sense. And I think we did have a y-intercept. So in fact, we do have that so we can piece it together. And that's it.